self action.
Watch the podcast.
I don't want this to be hurtful. The SEC is still the best conference in the world.
All right. I'm going to go cry now. Thanks for tuning in. See y'all Tuesday.
We're going to talk a little football.
Let's get it, baby.
Welcome, everybody, back to this week's episode of the Red Zone Faction. It is September 19th, 2017. We're going to start out with my State of the Faction address. State of the Faction address. Here I'm going to talk about my rants for the week. Mississippi State taking LSU down. Nobody saw this coming. If you saw this coming, you're lying. Even Mississippi State fans were. It's LSU. They're a powerhouse. LSU's supposed to be the number two team in this division. But this goes back to what I always say about it's Alabama and everybody else. All the radio stations, all the experts are out there today yelling, Alabama better look out. Mississippi State could beat them. This, that, and the other. This is exactly what I'm talking about in the SEC. It's not Alabama and everybody else, and this is why. But everything we say this week is going to change next week. It's just the way it is. Mississippi State taking out LSU was insane. Nobody saw that coming. The Florida-Tennessee game was probably the most boringest game I've ever seen in my entire life. That was terrible, and it ended up with a Hail Mary at the end. Congratulations, Florida fans. I know you're happy. I picked Florida to win, so. And then we're going to skip over to the NFL real quick. Last night's game, you had the Giants and the Lions. Everybody had the Giants finishing well this year and doing well. They're starting the season 0-2, and they've got Philly next week in Philly. They're about to go 0-3. The Giants look bad. Their offensive line is horrible. The problem I'm having is, and I see this, the Giants have all the same problems the Eagles have. Their offensive line is playing questionable. I think our offensive line is much better. They're still not playing up to their potential. I think the Giants' offensive line is terrible. And they're not running. They have no running game. LeGarrette Blount didn't do anything this week. Smallwood couldn't get anything going. We ran the ball 13 times against the Chiefs this week. I was proud of my Eagles because Wentz kept us in the game. Did he make mistakes? Absolutely. But he kept us in the game. We only lost by a touchdown. The Chiefs are a Super Bowl contender. Now let's talk about the other game. Dallas Cowboys and the Denver Broncos. The Denver Broncos are not, in my opinion, a playoff team. They, in fact, if you go back and look at my old podcast, I predicted Denver to possibly finish last in that division. I still stand by that. I think Denver still finishes towards the bottom. This is what we thought they were. I will say this, and I'll end my rant on this note. We found out Sunday night, Dak Prescott cannot read defenses. If he could not see what the hell Denver was doing defensively, and they were shutting him down, and Zeke completely quit. I mean, Zeke quit on this team this week, and you saw that. He had no production. He wasn't even, it was like he wasn't even in the game. Or you've got Zeke on your fantasy teams. If I were you, I'd be worried. The Cowboys play the Cardinals on Monday Night Football this coming week. I expect Dallas to get a victory again this week, and you know, they'll start turning around. But Dak is not the quarterback everybody thought he was. That's a fact. Think about that before everybody starts putting the Cowboys in the playoffs and the Super Bowl. Think about that, because there's no way. And not to mention the fact the AFC is so superior right now to the NFC. The AFC is so strong. You got the Patriots, the Steelers, the Raiders, the Chiefs. Those four teams right there are all better than any team in the NFC. All of them. Yes, that includes the Falcons. Yes, that includes the Packers. And I'm an NFC fan. The AFC is just far superior right now. And honestly, it has been for a long time. It's just the NFC's just, you know, they've had the Seahawks even have had their day in the sun. One of those four teams will go to the Super Bowl and play whoever wins the NFC, and they're probably going to spank them. Just be ready for that, because I don't know who's going to win the NFC. It's so up for grabs right now. There is more weak NFC teams than there is strong powerhouses. We're going to move on, and we're going to hit some college football. Let's go ahead and check out some of these scores and stats. Alabama took care of Colorado State, 41-23. Mississippi State with the game of the week, shock of the year to this point. Mississippi State taking out LSU, 37-7. Fitzgerald had a hell of a game. Completed 15 passes for 180 yards, 2 touchdowns. And that's really not even saying enough about what he did. I think Fitzgerald is really, really, really having a good year. I know we're only a couple of weeks in, but boy, You know, if you're Alabama, you're looking over your shoulder, Mississippi State right now. Auburn beats Mercer 24-10. Petway had a hell of a game, 34 carries, 128 yards, 3 touchdowns. Vanderbilt beats Kansas State. Florida wins at a Hail Mary, 26-20 over Tennessee. Purdue beats Missouri. Why are they in this conference? I don't understand. I wish we could make a trade and give them back. Missouri, I don't know. Why can we just give them back to the Big 12? Like, I don't. Kentucky beats up on South Carolina, 23-13. And Cal beats Ole Miss 27-16. Didn't see that game coming. I really thought Ole Miss would take care of business at Cal. But that West Coast, I tell you what, I always say it's something else. When you play on them, when those Eastern teams play a West Coast team, it's never good, whether it be NFL or college. I don't know. Maybe it's the time deal, but it always comes back to get you. Those are the scores in the SEC this week. Let's talk about some games to watch this coming Saturday. Texas A&M is at Arkansas. That's probably the lightest of it. State at Georgia is probably going to be the game of the week. A lot of people have Georgia taking the East. And the fact that Mississippi State just took care of LSU. Now, will they be coming off an emotional high? Yeah, they're probably taking a good look at themselves and flexing their guns. And, you know, they're probably a little high right now. So we'll see if Georgia can bring them down to level. This game's going to tell me a lot about these two teams in general, where State at versus where Georgia's at. This is going to be a good game, and it's going to explain a lot. Syracuse is at LSU this week. I think Syracuse is about to feel the wrath. It's going to be like one of those New England Saints games, New England Patriots Saints games, where you just poke the bear, and that next one's about to take it. So I think LSU gets a hefty win over Syracuse. Auburn is at Missouri. This ought to be a decent game. Probably high scoring. But there's no way Auburn's going to lose this game. I think Auburn's got this in the bag. Missouri's defense is atrocious. And Auburn's defense is very, very solid. I will talk all day long about Auburn. But their offense and how bad it is. But their defense is legit. And not a single person in this world can deny that. Auburn's defense is real. And that's why they're going to beat the tar out of Missouri. There's no chance in hell Missouri wins that game. And then Florida is at Kentucky. This game here is the second best game of the week. I know people say it's Kentucky, but Kentucky just beat South Carolina, and Florida looks bad. Between those two things, I think Kentucky definitely has a shot at winning this game. It's in Kentucky, and you know how I feel about home field advantage. I like Kentucky here, but I'm going to take Florida because I do think they're the better team. And but, dude, don't be at all surprised if I'm here next week talking about Kentucky beating Florida. Just saying. I'm not confident at all in that. Outside of the SEC, we've got a couple of good matchups. How about that powerhouse matchup between ODU and Virginia Tech? Crickets. USC is at Cal. I think USC will win, but don't sleep on Cal. TCU is at Oklahoma State. This is another good game. I'm going to take Oklahoma State here, but only because of the home field advantage, because I think TCU is a solid team, and that should be good. I will definitely be keeping my eye on that score as the night goes on. And then we're going to turn our attention over to the NFL. What is the deal with Thursday night games? I should have put this on my rant earlier. Like, NFL just needs to do away with Thursday night games because, dude, I don't remember the last good Thursday night game. I mean, the opener was decent because it was Kansas City and New England, but outside of that, when's the last time you remember seeing a good, solid matchup on Thursday night? Can we just do away with the Thursday night games? The coaches and the players don't like it anyway. I mean, I feel like it's irrelevant. Let's get rid of the Thursday night games and just go back to playing on Sunday, because it's really affected Monday night football, too, if you look at it. I mean, growing up as a kid, Monday night football was awesome. Monday night football is not good anymore, either. But I'd rather have Monday night football than Thursday night football. I think Thursday night football is ridiculous. And if you're not going to put a good matchup on, then who cares? I mean, really, in all honesty, it's just for fantasy football purposes that I'm paying attention, because the games are terrible. This week, you've got the Rams and the Niners playing. I mean, I don't understand. And this past week was a sleeper with the Texans and the Bengals. I mean, oh, my God. I mean, really? That game was terrible. The Texans over the Bengals. The Cardinals beat the Colts. Chiefs beat the Eagles. Patriots beat the Saints. Steelers beat the Vikings. Bucks beat the Bears. Panthers beat the Bills. Titans beat the Jaguars. Ravens were over the Browns. Seahawks were over the Niners. Raiders were over the Jets. Dolphins were over the Chargers. The Lions last night beat the Giants. Those were my correct. And then over here on the back end, you had the three that I got wrong this week. And I'll be honest with you, if I could go back and change some of these, I possibly would. I thought really and truly the Cowboys would beat the Broncos. They are, I feel like, going in a more superior team. But when Dak played like he played, they exposed Dallas for who they were. So that's why, I didn't see that coming with the Broncos. The Broncos are not a playoff-ready team, in my opinion. Their defense is legit. I mean, their defense is probably arguably one of the best in the NFL. But offensively, I mean, your quarterback's Trevor Siemian. I mean, how good do you expect to be? So, and your running game, even though C.J. Anderson blew up this week, how long until he gets hurt or whatever? And then your backup running back, Jamal Charles, is injury-prone. So, overall, Broncos long-term, not happening. So, and then the Falcons over the Packers. I picked the Packers to win. I think that my heart was a little bit more involved in that than anything. I like the Falcons, but I've always been a closet Packer fan as well. My Andy Reid days have always kind of, and I've had a lot of buddies through the years, big Packer fans. So, I've always pulled for the Packers. They're like a sister team to my Eagles, and I think that had more to do with it than anything. And I do think the Packers and the Falcons are both going to be playing each other again. This was an NFC Championship game last year. And if that doesn't happen again this year, I'll be shocked. Like I said, the NFC is so watered down, so diluted. You've only got one or two teams that are, you know, worthy of that of a Super Bowl from that end. So and those are definitely, Packers and the Falcons are definitely two of those teams. They are superior to just about everybody else in the NFC. So I fully expect those two to get back. My sleeper teams, well, you know, watch out for Tampa. I think that's what Falcons need to keep their eye on, is Tampa being in their division. And the Lions, let's not leave them out either. Now, I'm a little on the fence with the Lions, but I will say my good and then I will say my bad. The Lions are offensively, they're a great team. And they're even last night against the Giants. They really played the Giants well on defense. I don't know if that was a tribute to the Giants just sucking terribly. But I do believe that the Lions are legit. But we played 2 weeks of football. They beat the Cardinals with David Johnson getting hurt in the game. And now they beat a depleted, terrible offensive line Giants, and they expose the Giants for who they really are. So until the Lions beat somebody, wait until the Lions play the Packers, and then I'll have my real true feelings on Detroit, because I don't really know. I mean, they look great, they do, but they lack the running game. You're running Abdullah and Riddick, your running back committee, and there's nothing wrong with that. People win in the NFL with the committee. But their wide receivers, I like Galladay. I want to wait for the Packer game before I give my complete analysis on the Lions now that we're into the season. But everybody's all, you know, Detroit, 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 Detroit. Wait a minute. Pump the brakes. I'm with you, and I see it. But let me wait till they play somebody who's worthy of giving all that to, because they really haven't played anybody yet. I mean, last week's game against Cardinals, if David Johnson doesn't get hurt and they win that game, then I'm looking at them like, okay, I've got a little bit more. I understand. There's a little bit more work there. Got it. You beat the Cardinals without David Johnson, and then you just beat a depleted Giants, which everybody thought was going to the Super Bowl. Everybody put New York Giants in the Super Bowl before we even started the season, because they did a lot of work in the offseason. They did. They brought Brandon Marshall in. Two drop passes last night that were crucial. And then you brought in Evan Engram, that tight end from Ole Miss, who turned out to be a stud. He had a lot of catches last night. Apparently, he's the only one on that offense that could catch. And I don't think Beckham's 100%, so I'm not at all surprised about his debut last night. It didn't turn out fantastic. I know I benched him in my fantasy league, so I was happy that I had done that, considering the fact I'm 4-0 this week in fantasy. Speaking of fantasy football, let's move on to that.
Yeah.
We're going to start off with the Lost Tribe of Alabama. Let's get on with the LTA here. LTA, Warriors finally get a win. They take out the 10s, regulators, and team in the A-team. Boy, I tell you what, man. Let me say this before I go any further. We had three games literally go down to late Monday Night Football. Man, I don't ever remember seeing that in this particular league. Most of us in this league have been playing together for a decade or more. This week was insane fantasy football in this league. I can't get over it. But, yeah, because the Warriors and the 10s, they literally went down with Golladay in last night. He didn't do a whole lot. Thank goodness my Warriors won. But don't get it twisted. I was sweating all night last night. The regulators and the A-team was another one that went down the same thing. I mean, it literally went down to the last carry this group did. And this was even closer than the Warriors and the 10s. This literally went down. Carries were involved here in the last second of the game. You know, it was one of those things where every play and what they did mattered there at the end of the game with the Lions. And, man, boy, what a great game. Congratulations for Allen for taking that out, taking A-team out like that. I mean, that game was literally less than a point. I mean, ridiculous. And then you had the Bombers taking out Vatek, and that game was probably, yeah, that game was the butt-whooping on the week, according to Yahoo, 130-91. And then you had Team Dirty. I can't believe this. Dude, was he not? He finished second scoring this week with 137-30 behind the Warriors. And that is insane. Taking out Insano. Insano only scored 98 points, which is really odd. But I know he had Zeke. Insano has Zeke and Bell. I mean, that was unheard of. And nobody saw that coming either. Insano has a good team. And I know inevitably they'll be in there. They're 0-2 right now, but I'm not sleeping on them. They're not done. They're going to be at the end, I promise. They're going to be in there. To finish it up was the next to closest game outside of the regulators and the A-team. This was the second closest. This game literally came down to field goals because Roadkill and the Soldiers were literally going in. And the Soldiers were done at 137. The Roadkill, all they had left was Prater. And he's down like 9 points or 10 points. And he needed Prater, the kicker from Detroit, to kick as many field goals as humanly possible. You know, at least to give him a three and an extra point to tie this thing. Because they were literally down exactly like 10 points, I think it was. But it was insane. And literally all, if the Giants had stopped Detroit last night on that very last drive back at the 30-yard line-ish, they could have possibly stopped them and forced them to kick that field goal. And Roadkill walks out with the win. But instead, they don't. Giants let him get the first down. They move down. They run it all four times because they're running out the clock. And the Soldiers get the victory. Boy, what a week. What a week of fantasy in this league. I've never been that watching. I mean, as many games as I was, because it didn't even really dawn on me. I went to the site and I noticed the Soldiers and the Roadkill game. And then, you know, the guys over here, the regulators, was like, hey, wait a minute, what about our game? This is what I'm watching. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's even closer, because that's literally running back touches are going back and forth here. And just really, really, really enjoy this week of fantasy football in this league. And congratulations to those. Now let's look at the standings. Now we're going to roll over to the Red Zone faction. Butt whooping of the week, the Dream Killers over bye week, 131-77. Tuna Wranglers did what the Tuna Wranglers have been doing, 138 points. The league's high this week was Doug at 150. Huh. Okay, anyway, another good week here for RZF. This coming week, Dream Killers take on the Silverbacks. Of course, I'm taking my Killers. Ball Bulls are at bye week. Ball Bulls are going to go 3-0. Franklin's got Dirty. This game, I think, is going to be a little bit more competitive. I think Franklin can hang in there. I'm going to give Doug the win, but don't sleep on Franklin. He's got a secret. He's got a secret that I only know about, and I'm telling you, I think Franklin could pull this out this week. So pay attention to this. Watch that game with Franklin and Doug. Tuna Wranglers and the Destroyers. These are the only two undefeated teams playing each other. I look forward to watching and see how this turns out. I'm going to take the Wranglers, but Destroyers could pull this off. So I'm on the fence with this one, but I think the Wranglers have just this much better team. So we'll see how that one turns out. Don't sleep on Matt. I've kind of picked against. I feel like I've been picking on Matt. I picked against Matt this is the second week in a row. So, man, I'm not picking on you. I actually think you could win this game. I like Winston's roster about that much more. So, good luck to y'all this week, and we'll see how that turns out. Then you've got two 0-2 teams going against each other with the PSK and Michael's team. I'm going to take Michael's team because, again, I like it a lot, but that much more. PSK can get a win here. He lives on waivers. Have faith in who you got. Go with him. Roll with him. And, and give it a chance, Tyrone, because if you're changing out your players every 30 seconds and I see you pick somebody up, drop somebody, pick somebody up, drop somebody. Don't get me wrong. You're playing waivers. You're playing the game. But, let's see what happens here. All these games are intriguing. I got the Silverbacks this week. I'm not going to this with my eyes closed because I know he's going to come out swinging. He's 0-2. I'm 1-1, so I'm not perfect either. So this will be a good matchup. I think the Bulls are going to slaughter bye week. Burt's just got a hell of a team in this league, and I think that he's got this in the bag. Anyway, let's look at the standings for this week. So that's it for fantasy football. Leave your comments and questions and anything and concerns down below. Thank you for watching this week. I'm Scott Wilson. This is the Red Zone Faction. Like, share, subscribe. We'll see you next Tuesday. God bless.
Leave the comments down below.